Down in the bayou, all questions focus on offense.
Leonard Fournette, ready to kick that turbo in. Leonard Fournette, touchdown! My gosh, he's a freshman!
Will Leonard Fournette blossom into a Heisman frontrunner? What will last year's other freshman phenoms do for an encore? And an all-too-familiar refrain, who will flourish under center for the Tigers?
Hello and welcome to the LSU Football Preview Show. I'm Maria Taylor and I will be joined later in the show by Marcus Spears and Matt Stinchcomb. So the Tigers are coming off the heels of an 8-5 season and looking to make their way back to the top of the West. And Les Miles, he enters the season with questions at quarterback, and all the while a new defensive coordinator is making Baton Rouge his home. But Coach Miles found the time to give me a couple of answers about his Tigers 2015 outlook during SEC Media Days.
Get to spend a little bit of time with Les Miles, the head coach of the LSU Tigers. Coach, you have some great nicknames, I have to say. Some of the most infamous, the Hat, the Mad Hatter. Can you kind of tell me where that came from?
I have no idea. I think it has to do with this hat that I wear. It has a little bit of height to it, and not necessarily is it routine, a cap that everybody wears.
Well, as you enter your 11th season at LSU, which is always impressive, the tenure in the SEC, how have you grown or what have you learned since coming to Baton Rouge?
Well, it's first of all, you're thrilled to have worked with some really quality players and people, the assistant coaches that work tirelessly to put together great game plans, the great players that really affect you and have impact on you. I think it's humbling. I think it's humbling to be at an LSU for going into your 11th fall and realizing the success that we've had, and that, in fact, these people that I was fortunate to work with achieved greatly.
I think Leonard Fournette is a sleeping giant that's ready to wake up.
Fournette into the boundary, and he's going to waltz in. His number again, burst for the touchdown, buries the defender.
He is a special, special talent.
Fournette into the secondary, runs over a man. Leonard Fournette, touchdown.
We'll start with Leonard Fournette because he's one of the givens that we know going into the season. How has he grown? Knowing that he came in as the nation's number one recruit, that's a learning curve when you get through your freshman year. How is the second season different?
Well, he's a little bit more elite, a little bit, he trimmed some weight. He's a little stronger, maybe a little faster. I think he's comfortable in his own skin. I think he understands that we need to be a great team. He needs to have impact and contribution on that team. I don't think there's distraction and noise that's going to affect him. I think he's, again, humble. And I think he'll end up being the leader of our team.
Okay, so we talked a little bit about the knowns. Let's go with the unknowns, which is the quarterback position. What are you looking for? How do quarterbacks separate themselves for that starting role throughout camp?
At this point in time, both guys can operate the offense. Both guys can get it called. Both guys can understand snap, cadence, stem motion. We're looking for now what advantages are given to the offense by their contribution. Can they disconnect and run for a big play? Is there an opportunity for them to throw these throws as opposed to, where's his advantages? And if the one separates himself from the other by showing that these are my advantages and disadvantages the offense best. I'm told that Brandon Harris has had a nice summer. It'd be interesting to see how prepared he is for the ball.
What would you say would be a successful season for the LSU Tigers in 2015?
Well, certainly we want to be in the playoffs. We want to win the championship. It really kind of depends. I would consider these to be successful characteristics. They all buy in that this is a team and that everybody's doing things for others, that we work hard, that we're physical, that we take care of the ball. All these characteristics that are that we kind of point at LSU as a characteristic of a champion. If they approach that, they buy in, they do all those things, they work hard, they're physical, they take care of the ball, I think we'll win a lot of games.
I'll tell you about two guys who are physical back in their playing days. The unofficial line of scrimmage, Marcus Spears, former defensive lineman for LSU, former offensive lineman from Georgia, Matt Stinchcomb. They're going to try and get through the LSU football preview together. Guys, and for the Tigers, it seems like it starts with Leonard Fournette. That was the known commodity that Les Miles was talking about in SEC media days. Marcus, how do you see him separating himself in his sophomore campaign?
Well, the advantages you have of having a great player coming back is that it gives everybody on the team confidence. We can hand this guy the ball, and we should be okay. So I think his progression from last year to this year is he'll have more to load. Last year he was able to kind of get behind some guys. He's learned the system. There's no more hiding for number 7. Every defense will be lit up to stop him from running, so he has to make that progression.
It was hard enough for him to sneak up on folks last year because it wasn't like he eased on into this conference. Everybody knew about Leonard Fournette coming out of high school. But I think he did kind of have to spool up some of those talents, get used to the pace of play, the physicality of the play here in the Southeastern Conference. But also keeping in mind that, as you pointed out, to have a center of gravity offensively, to know what you can build your offense around, that cornerstone talent, that is a pretty nice security blanket. If you're Cam Cameron, if you're the quarterback-to-be, if you're the offensive lineman in the huddle, to know that you've got this guy to be your workhorse on offense.
Absolutely.
Yeah, he set the LSU freshman record, over 1,000 yards rushing in his first season in Baton Rouge. Do you feel like there's someone to back him up? Will he be able to share the load with other backs in a different style?
Yeah, I think Darrell Williams would be a great compliment. He's a physical guy in between the tackles. LSU is going to run the football. That's what they do. That's what their offense hinges on, and then creating some play action passes. And then Geis, a freshman that has come in, very highly touted. So they keep the staple. The cupboard is not bare at the running back position. I think they'll be fine with those two guys behind him, but he's definitely the horse in the race.
Yeah, he's the lead sled dog. Anything else we want to throw out there, he's the head guy. The thing is, I like Geis, especially on third down. You know, a little bit of Terrence McGee in him, I think. But we also got to keep in mind that last year, Leonard Fournette, what kind of numbers could he have put up if he had a complimentary passing game? And so it can't just be all run, run, run. And for LSU, it almost was in 2014. They need answers at other positions to help complement that running game.
All right, well, let's talk about that position. It's the quarterback position, which was the question mark going into 2014. Still the question mark going into 2015. Not exactly sure who's going to be starting for Les Miles. But we do know that Brandon Harris is in his second year for the Tigers in Baton Rouge. And Anthony Jennings, who got the start last season. Jennings started 12 of 13 games for the Tigers, but the offense was more efficient with Harris taking snaps. LSU averaged almost 7 yards a play when Brandon was in the game and scored a touchdown about once every 11 plays. So, guys, I'll toss it up to you first, Marcus. Who would you like to see leading LSU's offense to start this season?
Throw me in there. I think Brandon Harris. I think the situation he was put in last year at starting at Auburn at Jordan Hare was just a bit too much for him, not having those repetitions behind him. I think this is the guy. And look, you know, as much as people want to hide around it, Anthony Jennings getting in trouble this offseason definitely puts him at the forefront in this position, not to mention that people think he's more talented. And he's done some great things and shown flashes of being a real good quarterback. Now he just needs to take a hold of the offense and make this a better football team by his quarterback play.
The missing piece that I saw in Brandon Harris last year, we saw him versus New Mexico State live, and we're going, this is the guy. He's ready. Except he wasn't. Yeah. Especially throwing him to the Wolves or to the Tigers, I guess, the other version at Auburn. That was a tough way to get going for him at the quarterback position in his first start. But you know, if you can take silver linings out of suspension, and you look at Anthony Jennings being away from the football team for 6 weeks, now Brandon Harris doesn't have that other quarterback to deal with. He's the guy. At least for that six-week period, he has to be the guy. And I think that gave him an opportunity to grow a little bit from a leadership standpoint and let those guys on that team realize this could be our quarterback. And I think that was an element that he was missing a season ago. The talent clearly seems to be there.
And the good news for whoever ends up taking the snaps, they will have pretty much every productive wide receiver back this season, including Trayvon Doral, who led the Tigers in every receiving category a season ago. All right, this is the drill that separates the boys from the men. We're going to take you inside the Big Cat Drill and give you a preview inside the LSU program. And the Tigers coming off that 8-5 season, but do Marcus and Stinch see a trip to Atlanta for a champ? Well, here's what we know. Defensive coordinator John Chavis has moved on to Texas A&M, which ushers in the Kevin Steele era in Baton Rouge. Steele is the fourth defensive coordinator at LSU in Les Miles' 10-year tenure. And Steele comes to the Tigers after spending last season as Alabama's linebackers coach. But it's hard to compare to the 20 years of SEC defensive coordinator experience that John Chavis is taking with him to the Aggies. And oh, by the way, these guys, they were teammates together for a season at Tennessee. But let's take a look at some of Kevin Steele's guys running the big cat drill in Baton Rouge.
What we'd like to do at LSU is we'd like to reduce football to a one-on-one opportunity. And so big cat is a physical combative drill where you teach guys, to play with leverage.
Big cat drill is basically a drill that us LSU Tigers use to see who's the bigger, badder cat in that rep.
Big cat drill is energy, enthusiasm, passion.
I don't know how to keep scores, but just know whoever goes backwards, they lose.
It's something that really just can't be described. You have to see it. You have to see it to really know what LSU football is all about.
It's basically a one-on-one drill, fourth and inches, see who can get who moved across the line of scrimmage. I like to call one of those drills that it's a grown man drill. It's not for the weak or the timid.
It's become really an emotional thing for our guys. Our guys love to. They want to see. They want to see who the big cat is.
If you got any weak or timidness in you, you'll be thrown out the cage.
When we see Coach Miles laughing and having a good time out there, that's how we know this is our environment. This is us.
This is one of the drills that we've always had and always will have.
I don't think anybody in the country gets out there like us in a big cat drill.
To look inside the big cat drill, I would call it the tap out drill because as soon as I got in the circle, I would be tapping out. But probably you guys actually had to deal with it at some point. Do you remember going through that in college?
Oh, yeah. We were subjected to that. We were just talking about how you can really develop a lot of great technique. Doing that, right, man?
You never see that on the field ever, not during a game. But
this is what I would say to you, Stitch, if we were sitting in the green room. Mm. It's pointless. It's pointless. I don't think it shows any technique. It doesn't show anything football-wise.
So why do coaches do it?
Because they want to get the team going. They want to see who wants to practice that day. It's practice number 9,062 in fall camp. It's hot. We got to get these guys going some kind of way. So let's make them bang heads with each other to see if they're ready to go.
All right, we're going to try and come up with some version of the cat drill that we'll do in the green room. I'll videotape it for
wow.
you.
Wow. Move the furniture.
Yeah. Let's talk about LSU's defense, though. We know that the strength for LSU's D, and you said it, Marcus, has been the front seven in the past, but now with Kevin Steele, does that change at all in Baton Rouge?
I don't think so. I think you have to keep the same type of philosophy of what has made these defenses great in the past. And he understands the culture around LSU football, and that's big guys up front getting after it and having linebackers that can run and hit people pretty hard. And he has that with Beckwith. He loves Lockature's leadership, the way he plays the position. Listen, there are no superstars up front for LSU, but as a group, these guys play great, and they'll get after it together. And I think it's going to have to be more collective. You don't have any of those big names on that defensive line.
They might emerge, but you're right coming yep. into it. Why change the construct, really? I mean, you stay in a 4-3 defense. He's even going to maintain their dime package, the fabled Mustang package with 6 DBs. They love it at LSU. Why would you not yep. get that personnel grouping out on the field as much as you possibly can? But can that defensive front assert itself better this season? That's what I'm looking at, because we've seen LSU turn out top-level talent. They may not be top-level individual talents, but right. can that front four generate pressure and get tackles for loss the way they used to?
And LSU has been top of the league in total defense over the last 5 seasons, but this year they did suffer a setback. They will have to do without Jalen Mills, at least early in the season. Their safety suffered an ankle ankle injury during preseason camp and could miss 4 to 6 weeks. Mills is a four-year starter and a leader in the secondary. The Tigers senior is the team's most experienced player with 39 starts in 39 career games. Now, you know what to expect from LSU's front seven, and coming up, we'll take you inside their preparation for game day in SEC Inside. How does Coach Miles motivate his team? In the last four games for the Tigers is a bear. How will LSU finish out their conference slate with four straight West? Last season, LSU averaged 101,723 fans per home game. And if you have ever been to Death Valley for a night game, you know that there aren't many college football atmospheres that compare to the one in Baton Rouge. But all the fans that cheer on the Tigers Saturday nights rarely get an all-access pass to prep time that goes into building a top 25 team. That is until now. Let's take a look inside the Tigers prep for kickoff with SEC Inside LSU.
Okay, Hope.
You will enjoy this for me to say my father's first name and my sister's first name, Hope. This is where you gotta be quick. You gotta swallow him up. You gotta attack it fast. Rakevian! Now watch this. Tell me what you think he's doing, right or wrong, 41. He's too far back. He's not extending the split. That's the first thing. He waited. Mm-hmm. Instead of going to get it, he waited. The guy's going to look out. Mm-hmm. Take the next one. That's it. Nice shot. You see the width in the split and then his urgency with which to get to the guy who might be lined up in the seam and coming here or might stand up and go that way. Those two things. You got me?
Good.
That is a beautiful kick. Did you see that? I mean, they're going to all scurry to get to that. Hey, Trent! What a beautiful day, huh? How about this day? A little cloud cover? Can't beat it. What's going on, four? Nice to see you, babe. Beautiful day in Louisiana, a little overcast, nice little breeze.
Yes, sir.
Get flat and then come upfield. Nice job, 10. Really nice throw. Wow. You know what? That was a great throw. You know why? Here's why. Because he made a mistake, but the height that you put on that allows him to adjust and make the catch. Do you understand that? I mean, he had him pinned in. There's the good news. All you did is lay it over there, say, hey, listen, you got to get over there. And that's just what he did. Nice job. Use your hand. Put your hand on his inside number. I mean, no, you do this, you can't tell. But if you sit it down and put it on his inside number, it's over. Practice your brain on running. Let me tell you what you just did. You're the defender. I'm you. You know what that is? That's a shallow cut in front of a defender that knocks the living snot out of you, as opposed to somebody that comes up and shakes him and goes vertical. Nice shot. Honest to God, nice shot. Hey, did you see him look at you? Or did you let it go a little early? Maybe a little early. Hey, but let me tell you something. It was beautiful. A three, pin the defender inside you, and then now you have 5 yards to work. He's gonna be shoving like hell.
We got you. Rush the passer. Rush the passer. Sack. Nice job. Nice job.
Bad news.
Rank.
Gotta finish! Gotta finish! We're open! Left and right!
Jamal Adams! Nice play.
Hey, Carl! Carl!
Not too wide. Fight me inside. Fight me inside. Okay. You see what I'm saying? But I'm staying square. You got it? Watch him. Watch him. Tell me what he should do.
I like it. I like it. I turn him up quicker. It's cracking pretty good out there. Glad we rolled the top up. Run up field. God. I'm just telling you, you get 7 yards, you go that way. You dance, you get 3, okay? I'm just telling you, you gotta learn that as a young man. We're throwing the Hail Mary. First offense, defense, line it up.
You just throw a ball up there into the mix.
Nice job. Nice practice.
Thought there was a better practice. Improvement on both sides, I guarantee. A round of applause for this football team.
Family on 2, 1, 2.
Family. So that was a sneak peek at SEC Inside. You can catch the full episode when it premieres on September 9th, starting at 7 p.m. with Vanderbilt. Now, this is the part of the show that gets a little hairy, a little ugly, and it ruffles some feathers because we pull out the schedule predictor, and you guys have to decide how many wins LSU is going to have this season. We've already given them the gimme, so at worst, there would be 4-0 this season. Let's start on September 12th at Mississippi State, guys.
Marcus, I'm not worried about Mississippi State this year, man. Last year, even in the second half, LSU started crawling back into that ball game. Mississippi State was on this kind of charmed run early on in the season, but I think they take care of the Bulldogs early this year.
I think we've just become conscious to know. And with Mississippi State, it's too many unknowns. So I'm going to give them a win in Mississippi State and start Vegas.
And then, of course, it gets very real, very fast the very next week versus the other Tigers, the ones from Opelika, Alabama. What do you think of that one?
Well, first, I think this would be Brandon Harris's opportunity to kind of go and rectify what happened to him last year in Jordan Hare. They get him at home. They get him early evening. SEC Nation to be there. So I'm giving LSU the win.
Man, I think Auburn's going to be much improved. They're going to need to be. I do think that LSU's going to be far better prepared, especially if Brandon Harris is the quarterback, because he was not blessed with a lot of starts going into last year's matchup. I like Auburn in this one. Maria, you want to break the tie?
Yeah,
here?
Since you guys disagree, I'm just going to go ahead and step in and give them the W.
No, all right.
Side with Mr. Spears on this one. Sorry about that.
So the Tigers are going to win.
They're going to win.
Look, for South Carolina, this is a bounce-back season. Not saying it was terrible last year, but on defense, they were hard. And I don't think they have what it takes to do what they need to do to get a win against LSU this year.
We talk about quarterback questions all over this conference, but what South Carolina lacks, LSU certainly has, is they know what they can do on defense, even with Kevin Steele. And they've got Leonard Fournette in that offensive.
It's a pretty good first week.
That's a nice start.
Jim McElwain, first year going to Death Valley, still hadn't picked a starting quarterback. I think this is too much for the guy taking the snaps, and I think it's too much for University of Florida and where their program is this year. So I'm going to give LSU a win there.
I'm with you there. Go ahead and give it to them. No signature wins that time around. Western Kentucky, I think, is a given. And then, of course, the other squad from the state of Alabama.
This is where they take their first L, in my opinion. I think what LSU does well versus what Alabama will be up front with those 7 guys, I don't think it fares well for LSU and Tuscaloosa. I'm giving them a loss there.
I'm with you. Go ahead and knock them down. Dominant front 7 for Alabama. Yeah. And if you're going to be one-dimensional offensively, you're in trouble versus the Tide. I think Arkansas, they got blanked last year by the Razorbacks.
And I think that gives them a little motivation. They have to go to Death Valley, so I'm giving LSU the win. I know I sound like a major homer right now, but that's okay. I'm giving them the W when they come to Death Valley.
See, I like the Razorbacks on that one. So, Maria, you going to break this tie, too?
Yeah, I'm going to give Arkansas the win on this one.
Okay.
So hit the L for the Tigers.
Ole Miss defense is still going to be stout. I just hadn't seen this team turn the corner yet. LSU has proven they can win these type of games. So I'm going LSU with a W against
Ole Miss. I think LSU beats Ole Miss. And then A&M, of course, has proven to be an interesting one. A lot of speed on the field in that game.
A lot of speed on the field, but they match up well because that secondary is stout.
10-2, do they win the West?
No.
Oh, at least you guys agree on something. The LSU Tigers finished 10-2. We'll find out when the season starts against McNeese State in September.